Hello everyone, I hope you're doing well. This isn't the usual video, as those of you who are in the Surfside community, the Bell Harbor community, know, I'm in Canada right now. My father is scheduled to have an operation tomorrow morning, and so I've come up with my son Alexander to support him at that time. And I felt really badly that we'll miss the lecture on Gluckel of Hameln, who's a fascinating character. And I didn't want to push it off next week, because next week we're talking about the Ramchal, who's an absolutely fascinating individual, and I really don't want to sacrifice anyone on the list of the scheduled lectures. So I thought I would prepare a little bit and at least include our remarks on Gluckel of Hameln on this video presentation. I'm not sure how long I'm going to speak, because no one's going to interrupt with me with questions. Okay, that's it. I brought a copy of her memoirs up with me on the plane, and I read them over once again. Fascinating. And I made my little PowerPoint notes here. I'm not actually going to put together the PowerPoint until I get back to Florida. But in the meantime, here we are up in the Iroquois Falls, which is quite far north. We're about 150 miles south of the southernmost region of range of polar bears. I grew up here. My mother and father still live here. It's incredibly cold. It was 21 degrees below zero Celsius the other day. And that would translate into something about 12 degrees below zero Fahrenheit. It's really cold. It's fascinating for Alexander. He's never seen snow before. He's up here to support my mother and father and myself. He's taking care of a lot of the cooking and things like that, so that we can get through this difficult time together. But it's interesting because he's never seen snow before in his life, and he had a lot of misconceptions about it. He thought that, if you walked on a snowbank, it would hold you up. And he's learning a few basic rules, like, for example, you put your gloves on last. You have to put everything else on, then you put your gloves on. But we're having a pretty good time. And those of you who are viewing this through the link through the email that I send out to class members, you can see a few private emails of Alexander, for example, discovering a toboggan and discovering that you have to actually scrape the frost off the windshield and things like that. So here we are in Iroquois Falls, and I'm really hoping that everything will go well with the surgery, and tomorrow, on Monday, we'll be back in Florida. Okay, let's see. Oh, thanks to Judy Seed, because this lecture is sponsored by her. I really appreciate it, Judy. Thank you so much. And now we're going to talk about Gluckel of Hameln for about half an hour, 45 minutes, something like that. Okay, so Gluckel of Hameln, who is our topic for tonight, she was an upper middle class woman born in 1646. She passed away in 1724, and she lived, I think, a not unremarkable life by the standards of her gender and her social class of the time. But what makes her life so fascinating for us in the 21st century is the fact that she decided to commit it to writing. And in a series of seven books, which are known collectively as her memoirs, we actually have an extremely rare look into the life of a woman of the 17th century, particularly a Yiddish woman writing in Yiddish. It's exceptionally rare. We really have a very special document that tells us so much about her society, her class of the time, and so on. And I'll talk about the value of the document in the next little while. The memoirs themselves were written between 1690 and 1719, and of course they cover a period all the way up from 1648. Some of her earliest memories are mentioned there in the wake of the Khmelnytsky rebellion of 1648-49. Her name Gluckel means little fortunate one, or little happy one. Glück in German means happy, fortunate, lucky. It's often pronounced Glück in Yiddish, or Gluck. It's the same word, Gluckel. And the little L at the end is a diminutive, meaning little happy one, little fortunate one. Hameln is the smallish city that she lived in for most of her life. She was born, she was married to a man named Chaim of Hameln, hence Gluckel of Hameln. At this point, Jews were not regularly using last names. That would only develop later as the modern European states would begin to assign people last names, and quite often these names were simply absorbed from their lineage. Like, for example, my own name, Abramson. Chances are that at the time that my ancestor was first required to choose a last name. Any questions in the back there? Oh, just kidding. My ancestor was first required to choose a name. His father was probably named Avram, and since he took the name Abramson, you know, very straightforward. Sometimes there were bribes involved in choosing names. For example, a name like Rosenthal or Rosenzweig, which are considered very beautiful words, like, you know, field of roses and things like that. You might have to pay for those. You might have to be on a higher social class to get that. Sometimes they came from professions like Shochet, if you were a slaughterer, or Schumacher, if you were a shoemaker, things like that. And sometimes they were punitive, especially in Austria. Jews would get names like Zwiebel, which means onion, or my favorite, Katzenellenbogen, which means cat's elbow. And that was often because you fell out of favor with the name-granting authorities to give you that. But at any rate, her last name, she really didn't use one, but they knew her as Gluckel of Hameln. She was actually born in nearby Hamburg, where her father had a prominent position. He was the Parnas. He was the president of the Jewish community there. And at the age of two, one of her earliest memories is that she was forced with her family and all the Jews of Hamburg to flee to Altona because they were expelled from Hamburg at that time. after a short period of time, they were allowed to return back to Hamburg, but they never received formal right of residence at the time, which meant that their existence there was basically year to year at the whim of the municipal authorities. And she describes the humiliation that they went through of not being allowed to erect their own permanent synagogue. They had to conduct their prayers in small shtiblach, informal prayer houses in homes, and whenever these would be discovered, then they would be immediately shut down, and the Jews would have to walk the 10 kilometers or so to Altona for formal Shabbos services. They weren't allowed to have even informal ones in their home. This is one of the kind of interesting things about the Gluckel's memoirs, is that you get a little bit of a sense of the tenuous nature of the status of Jews in Europe at the time. And I am going to talk about that explicitly, but first, this is where I'd normally pause for a question so I could take a quick drink of coffee. Delicious. I said a bracha before. Okay, here we go. So, she received as a child a very good secular and Jewish education, although one of the things that she lamented for most of her life was the fact that she never learned French. It's fascinating. Later you see, as she moves in high society, high Jewish society, she's expected to know French, and people would greet her in French, and it was not at all a language that was au courant among Jews of the time. The Yiddish was the vernacular, and business language might have been conducted in German or Polish, whatever had to be done in the streets. But French was the language of high culture, and a Jew who didn't know French was considered somehow, you know, culturally illiterate. She does tell a fascinating story of a friend of hers who had a young daughter, and the friend was, you know, a Jewish businessman, and he was holding pledges against loans, a kind of a pawnbroking industry, which Gluckel was also involved in, and was very common in the Jewish community at that time. And a certain nobleman conspired to go back to retrieve his pledge and then to run out of the house without paying and then have the Jew come and try to collect the money that was originally loaned to the petty nobleman. So while the nobleman with his friend were waiting in the anteroom, and they had asked the Jew to go get the pledge so that they could redeem it, of course they had no intention of redeeming it, they were talking about this with one another in French, not realizing that the Jews 8-year-old daughter playing the piano was in fact fluent in French because her father had given her lessons. And when her father came down, the daughter began singing in Yiddish, "Oh no, don't give them the pledge." And then he realized, of course, what was going on, and he demanded the money first before giving back the pledge. So Gluckel remarks on this story as an example of one more reason why you really have to learn French. At any rate, here comes my son in to check out what's going on. Do you want to step into the camera and say hello? Or no? Okay. No. No, you know, but...
See your lecture!
I'm giving a lecture. Okay, all right. So you can pretend to be the audience if you want. All right. She did receive a good Jewish and secular education. There's evidence, literary evidence from the memoirs, that she could read Hebrew. And, of course, she was fluent in Yiddish. There's Alexander. Yeah, okay, get out of the camera now. Okay. So, and she was quite familiar with a lot of halacha, especially business halacha, which she referred to from time to time in her business dealings. And she was quite conversant with Musar literature, which she quotes frequently in the memoirs.
Professor, I have a question.
Oh my gosh, Alexander.
Would you like peanut butter and jelly in your breakfast sandwich, or would you like just a plain?
Okay, you know, you could probably ask me this question later, but peanut butter and jelly will be fine. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor. I really need to know that.
All right, okay, no more questions, please, until I finish. The coffee is very good, though. Thank you, Alexander.
I'm no problem.
Okay, all right, now, she was...
I learned it from those Jones O'Hara Weiss, how they always do, eh?
Oh, yeah, Jones O'Hara Weiss. You want to mention them too? Okay, good.
Go, you guys!
Okay.
Yay!
Okay, all right. Let me give this lecture, okay? This is, like, not professional at all. I'm going to have to double my fees. All right. So, she was betrothed, engaged at age 12 to Chaim, and then married to him 2 years later. It's quite a long engagement process, which was apparently very common at the time. She would eventually bear him 13 children, a remarkable 12 of whom would survive to adulthood. Gluckel of Hameln. You missed the first part of the lecture, so...
We want pumpernickel or onion? I mean, poppy seed. Or onion.
Poppy seed, okay. Go, make. He's making the lunches for tomorrow when we go to the hospital. Okay,
bye.
All right. All right.
This guy's so good.
Okay, go.
I love
go,
him. He does it so good.
Yeah, okay. All right. Boy, that felt so good, didn't it? Okay. All right. Anyway, she was married to Chaim for 30 years, and then she was widowed at age 54. And I'll speak a little bit about her life after widowhood, which is also quite fascinating. But at this time, let's look at the memoirs themselves and their value for historians. So first of all, as I mentioned, there are 7 books. They date from 1690 to 1719. Her stated purpose for writing these memoirs was to inform her children and grandchildren and other descendants of the nature of their lineage. She wanted to convey the sense of what kind of people they came from. And so it has a strong genealogical trend within the entire work. Implicitly, there's a phenomenal amount of musar in the text, meaning she's giving them exhortation as to how they should live their lives. It's extremely important to her that they absorb some of the fundamental lessons of life that she absorbed from her parents, from her husband, and from the school of hard knocks that she endured. She denies this. She actually has a very appealing, self-deprecating manner where she speaks of herself as a sinner and she speaks of herself as having, you know, wronged many people and so on. But in reality, she is very conscious of the Musar literature and she gives a lot of it over in the text. We are not well served by her editors. The first published version of Gluckel of Hameln's memoirs came out in 1896 and a few other editions in German translation, Yiddish, and in Hebrew, and later an English translation came out. But almost all of them removed so much of the Musar material that she gives over, feeling that it represents excessive moralizing and so on. And I think that's an unfortunate omission. I think I would have liked more to know about what was valuable to her on a religious and ethical level, and I could have skipped a lot of the other stuff myself. But at any rate, the common English translation that's available today omits much of it and is not apologetic about it at all. Later, after the death of her husband, Chaim, she would state that the last two books in particular were written to drive away thoughts of melancholy. It was a cathartic, therapeutic activity that she engaged in, and she used it as a way to exorcise the demons that plagued her after having lost her life partner. Now, it's a fascinating text from a historiographic point of view. That is, when historians pick up a book like this and they say, well, what are we going to do with this text? On one level, this is just one woman's life as she describes it to her children. And, you know, she didn't, like, change the world in any dramatic and overt manner. If it were not for the memoirs themselves, chances are no one would have remembered her. Her audience was just the circle of her specific descendants and descendants after them. She had no, you know, larger literary ambitions besides that small coterie of readers. Although we do get a sense from her memoir of the reflections of larger historical currents, I'll tell you a little bit about some of the things that she says about Shabbatai Tzvi and the Chmelnytsky Rebellion and so on. So we sense how these made an impact on people of her class and so on. But I think the most important value we can get from this book is that it gives us just a snapshot. We don't know quite how representative it is. We have to work with the text to try and... Okay, sorry about that distraction. The memory in the camera was full and I had to play with the buttons and I did. And now we're back. Okay, so what is of value? What value can we get from this memoir of Gluckel of Hameln? I'd like to say something at the beginning. If you look through the book, there are two words that stand out. There are two words that are clearly the most commonly word used in the entire text. The first one is Reichstaler, and the second one is betrothal. The first word, the most common word in the memoirs of Gluckel of Hameln, perhaps with the exception of the word the, is the word Reichstaler, which is a unit of currency. It's about money. There's a lot of discussion of money in this memoir. Who is worth how much, and who's married to whom, who has how much, and how much money you can make this way, and how much money you can make that way, and how much money you lost or gained. Money is deeply, deeply important to Gluckel, and it's a major theme throughout the work. The second word, which is closely related to the first word, is betrothal. Gluckel spends the vast majority of her memoir talking about making money, saving money, protecting money, and marrying her kids off, hopefully to people with money. Now, I think it would be a misjudgment to say that that's all that she was about, but I would think that it's reasonable to say that these are the things that are foremost in her mind, the most pressing concerns. She's definitely a very pious woman. She has a lot of deeply pious sentiments, and I'd like to return to that later, but there's no question that this is a very bourgeois memoir. It's about the quotidian necessity of keeping food on the table, sometimes under very dire circumstances, at other times perhaps in the realm of more luxurious fare, but nevertheless there's a lot about money and a lot about connections to people with money. We never even learn, for example, the names of all of her children. And even those ones that we know their names, we only get passing reference to them, usually A, when she's about to betroth them to someone, or B, if they get very, very sick, or C, if there's something interesting about them, either dealing with business or with learning. She does have a few sons who seem to show significant promise in learning, and so she has some interesting asides on their life as scholars. Nevertheless, it's really all about money and connections to money. That's certainly the most prominent theme that runs throughout the book. And that says something about her class and gender, and I think it would be fair to say that this is an honest memoir, and it's probably true of most Jews today too, and most people today are very concerned about these very basic things. She's extremely dedicated as a wife and a mother. She wants to make sure that her children have the wherewithal to maintain their lifestyle and security, and then to pass this on to the next generation. Now, in terms of the value of the book, I'm going to break this down into a few areas where we see a special value and we learn a sense of things from Gluckel's perspective. First of all, the book is extremely useful to illustrate the status of Jews in late 17th and early 18th century Germany. I mentioned earlier the right of residence, which was an ongoing issue for Gluckel, the privileges of being able to live in a particular region, to establish synagogues in a particular region, to do business in certain ways, in certain professions, and so on. Secondly, very, very significant is the issue of safe passage. Traveling from one region to another, even a distance of 20 miles, was life-threatening. There are all kinds of stories that she relates of, carriages being impounded, and then the Jewish owners being tortured until they paid ransom. And this is from official government personages. At other times, there are bandits, and Gluckel, for example, describes how she had to travel in disguise so that she would not be seen as a Jewish woman. Passage oversea with pirates, incredible dangers, plying the kind of trade that we associate with Gluckel's life. She was, by the way, a merchant in gold and jewelry in particular. Later, she diversified into other fields as well, but gold and jewelry was her main currency. Related to this, for example, is the weak nature of the Rechtsstaat in which they lived, meaning the laws of the society could not be relied upon to protect the Jews under all circumstances, as would be expected. She tells one absolutely terrifying story about a Jewish neighbor who didn't come home one night. And, the wife is looking for him and can't figure out where he was supposed to be. And the story comes out, it's long and complicated, but basically they trick a non-Jewish maid from another home, another non-Jewish home, into confessing that her master and mistress had murdered the Jew, stolen his money, and had buried him under the threshold of their front door. And, the townspeople, the Jewish townspeople of Hameln, are very upset, and they go to the local police constabulary, and the attitude of the police is, you have some evidence, you have the testimony of this non-Jewish maid, we're not about to go digging up people's front, who's here? Alexander's back? Okay. We're not about to go digging up people's living room floors on the basis of your say-so. Okay, you're ruining the lecture here. Okay, come on, this is serious. And but the Jews are adamant that they believe that that's where the other Jew is buried, and the constabulary says, okay, fine, we'll do this, but if it turns out that you're wrong, then it's going to go hard on the entire Jewish community. Which is an absurd, ridiculous statement, but nevertheless, that was the kind of situation the Jews lived in. As it turned out, they dug up the floor of this person's home. They found the dead body there. The non-Jewish culprits were, in fact, punished for this crime, and the Jewish community was what's the right word? I don't know. Alexander's very distracting here. He's finding all kinds of flashlights and things like this. There's also occasional references in Gluckel Hameln's book to, the relationship with the Jews from Poland, the so-called Ostjuden, or Eastern Jews, who were looked on with some disdain by the German Jews, and you get that sense from her memoirs as well. They certainly were considered much more shady characters by the German Jews. I think rather fascinating, this is new to me, the relationship with the Sephardic communities in Germany, who maintained themselves at some distance. They quite often had slightly better residence privileges and so on than the local Jews. Okay, Alexander, that's... Blow it out, please. Come on. What are you doing? Come
on. This match.
I'm giving a lecture, okay? You know, I know it doesn't seem like a lecture, but... Okay. The Sephardim, especially fascinating in this context, I think, was when the Shabbatai Tzvi debacle that we spoke about last week occurred in northern Germany. Whenever a letter arrived from Smyrna, maybe from Nathan of Gaza or someone else who was associated with the Shabbatai Tzvi movement, the Sephardim would invite the entire community to their shul, and everyone would be, the Sephardim in particular, would be dressed in green, and they would read the letter with great pomp and circumstance, and everyone was very excited about it. Gluckel's own father-in-law sold everything that he had and placed everything in non-perishable goods. He stored much of it with Gluckel for 3 years, waiting for the news of the arrival of Messiah. So definitely, Shabbatai Tzvi made an impact on the Jews of Germany as well. We also get a sense from Gluckel of the devastation wrought by the Chmelnytsky Rebellion of 1648-49, when so many refugees came to northern Germany that Gluckel's father put them up in their home, and she gave up her bed for... there were 10 of them staying in her home at that point. Second thing of value in Gluckel's memoirs is the status of women. It's fascinating because Gluckel never in her memoirs mentions any disadvantage to her status as a woman. Clearly, she understands there's a division of labor, and her task is to produce children basically every 2 years. But she is an active partner in her husband Chaim's business, and she prides herself on being his most prominent advisor. And then once Chaim passes away, she quite naturally steps into the shoes as the president and CEO of the business. Do not light any more of those, or it will set off the fire alarm.
Where?
It'll set off the smoke alarm.
Oh,
I'm serious, okay? Don't.
And cool
it'll here. Upset your parent, your grandparents. Kids. Okay. She's quite successful in business, too. She undertakes all of the same responsibilities that Chaim worked, including the international travel. At the same time, rearing the eight unmarried children that she still has at home and working towards their betrothals. That's that second word again. She takes into her business one of her sons who doesn't seem to be able to have a head for it, and she employs him as a junior partner. So she clearly is very, very competent in the business world, and she does not refer anywhere in her memoirs to any kind of disability that stems from the fact that she is a woman. She also mentions in this context some interesting stories, primarily that happened with various rabbis. There's an undercurrent of, on the one hand, piety and respect for rabbinical wisdom and learning in general, but a certain amount of disdain for the rabbis that she knows in particular. And they're viewed as sometimes even as charlatans, and the Beit Din is considered a flawed instrument of justice, but it's considered a chilul Hashem, a profanation of the divine name for Jews who have a dispute to take it to the secular court. So nevertheless, they put up with it. She has some amusing stories that cast some aspersions on local rabbis in this regard. And I think the most fascinating story that she tells, and this is one that perhaps she is at some disadvantage, maybe not so much because she's a woman, but because of her class, where she sends one of her brighter sons, Joseph, off to study with a particular rabbi. I think it's a Polish rabbi, actually. And it's for 6 months at a time, and the rabbi asks if he can be paid in advance. So it doesn't matter to her, she pays him in advance instead of, you know, in the middle or the end. And then she gets a letter from her son indicating that the Jews of that particular town are being hard-pressed by the local authorities, and they have to come up with thousands of dollars in ransom, and he's begging her for more money. And, she shows it to one of her other sons because it doesn't seem quite right, and so she sends one of her other sons over there, and they speak to the young boy, and it turns out that this rabbi was fleecing her son for money, even so far as to cut off the silver buttons on his coats. And with the older brother, they remove the son from that particular, poorly chosen yeshiva. So she perhaps was at some disadvantage there, but again, that was more of her class probably than her gender. Another area of value of the memoirs is in its description of religious rituals and folk culture as well. There's so many fascinating little tales that fit into it. Maisa Shahaya type stories, things that happen type stories. I'll only refer to one of them because it has so many fascinating details to it. Apparently a young woman died in childbirth, a woman known to Gluckel, and she was buried, and then she appeared to one of her friends in a dream saying that her grave was robbed and her tachrichim were stolen, her burial cloths were stolen. It seems that burial cloths, which were normally made out of cotton or, for more wealthy people, linen, were of significant value, enough to actually rob a grave over. At any rate, there was a hue and cry in the Jewish community, and ultimately they ended up exhuming the body, finding that in fact the tachrichim were stolen, so that was kind of a spooky thing to begin with. And then the second part of the spooky story is that when the women got together to sew new tachrichim, new burial shrouds for the deceased, one of the women looked up and saw an apparition of the young woman sitting together with them as they prepared these burial cloths. So the whole story, you know, contains so many elements of you know, greed and mystical and experiences and so on. These are the kinds of things that Gluckel reports of frequently in her memoirs. There is also, finally, fascinating information, I believe, in German folklore, because she reports several stories that, and parables and teachings and so on, that have no known Jewish source to me, and in fact, I would be highly surprised if, in fact, they do have Jewish origins. Like, for example, she tells one story, and this is meant kind of like as a Musser story for her children. It's got kind of a bizarre twist to it, that a certain nobleman was sent away by his father with a huge amount of money and told to find true friends. And so he went away to an island and he came back many years later, and his father, the king, said to him, "So how did you do finding true friends?" And he said, "Oh, I found hundreds of true friends." And so the king said, How did you get those true friends? Hundreds of them is an amazing number. And he says, "Well, I used to give these lavish dinner parties and I invited all these people and I gave them all kinds of gifts and they all became my true friends." And the king said, "Oh, Dummkopf, you stupid guy. Those are not true friends. If you want to know who is a true friend, then here's the part that doesn't seem particularly Jewish to me. What you got to do is you have to slaughter a calf and put it in a big sack and then carry it to all of your true friends and tell them that you have murdered someone and you need their help hiding the body. Then you'll see who your true friend is." And so that's what the guy does. He carries a sack and he goes to all these true friends. None of his true friends will actually help him hide the body until finally he goes to his valet, his personal butler, and the personal butler doesn't want to do it, but he's afraid that he'll be implicated, so he ends up helping him out. And so the prince goes to the father and says, "Well, you were right, Dad. I only found one true friend, and that was the valet." And the king says, "You didn't even find one true friend. He's only half a true friend because he really didn't want to help you in the first place." So the prince says, "So what should I do?" He says, "Well, first of all, you should beat all of the other people so that they will fear you, and you know, then you keep the valet with you." It's a bizarre story, but these are the kinds of stories that Gluckel will reveal in her discussions to her children as things that you know, have a certain moral truism, and even though they may not be of a Jewish source, they still have a valuable lesson to be learned. Another one that I really found fascinating as well is a father bird is carrying one of his young across a raging river, and the father says, while he's carrying the raging bird over, "My child, if I carry you over this river, will you care for me in my old age? And the bird says, oh, yes, father, I promise I'll care for you in old age. And the father says, liar, and drops him into the river and kills him. This happens several times. Again, it doesn't seem like a particularly Jewish story. But at any rate, it happens several times until finally he's taking one of his chicks over. And he says the question, will you take care of my your old age? Will you promise? And the baby bird says, father, I cannot promise that. But what I can promise you is that I will take care of my children as well as you have taken care of me. And with that, the father was satisfied, and the father bird brought that child over to the other side. And somehow I feel a connection to that story. Okay, so let's conclude by talking about the end of Gluckel's life. After losing her husband, she remained single for about 14 years, and then she was convinced by her children to engage in a match to another individual, also a very wealthy individual, the Parnas of the community of Metz, very large community. She was not inclined to do it at first. She describes her hesitancy, but ultimately she decides that she will in fact marry him. Their betrothal occurs in secret because there is, here's another one of the status of Jew issues, there's this huge tax on Jews leaving the town of Hamburg, where she was living at the time, and so she wants to clear out all of her business dealings and debts and so on before she moves to Metz to be with her new husband. She's married to him for a couple of years. She gives him a lot of her own money, which is to be returned to her and to her descendants at the end of the marriage, and then he promptly goes bankrupt, and he loses a tremendous amount of money, and he places her in near bankruptcy herself. And then he dies. So all of a sudden, after marrying this individual, Gluckel of Hameln finds herself in very straitened circumstances that she had not found herself in since her, actually at no point in her life. Nevertheless, she struggles mightily and is able to succeed in her business and to regain her footing. But ultimately, she is invited into the home of one of her daughters, who happened to marry into another very wealthy family. And it's an interesting kind of statement about Gluckel's life as well, which I think is especially evident upon reading. Her Machateniste, the mother of her son-in-law, was a woman named Frau Jachet. And throughout the first five books of her memoirs, she's always referred to as the wealthy Frau Jachet, or the rich Frau Jachet. It's like part of her name. That's the most important thing about her, is her wealth. And she has significant disputes with Frau Jachet. When her daughter is engaged to Frau Jachet's son, she receives a letter indicating that Frau Jachet's son is not at all the way he has been portrayed, and that it's not a worthwhile match. And she goes back and forth in correspondence with Frau Jachet for quite some time, with pushing off the wedding and trying to come to some terms. So, well, why don't you bring the son over here so we can check him out? And Frau Jachet says, no, 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 you bring your daughter over to us, and then we'll let you meet our son. And it's a huge da-da-dam about this marriage. And Gluckel clearly has a lot of reservations about it. But in the end, ironically, it is Frau Jachet and her son-in-law who take her in and treat her with tremendous respect and honors, and she lives out the last of her days in tremendous comfort in their home. She eventually passes away in 1724. So to return in conclusion to the criticisms of her work, certainly it does display a tremendous degree deal of bourgeois values. There's a lot in there which is really all about the Reichstaler and all about the betrothal and its relations to the Reichstalers and so on. But, you know, this is the way people have to live. Money is an essential part of human existence, and Gluckel is just being rather honest about, you know, what's important to her. And I think it would be unfair of us to judge her, particularly in a work that was semi-private, that was really intended only for her descendants, to pass some kind of judgment. Had she known that millions of people would be reading her book in the next few centuries, perhaps she would have changed her tone, perhaps she would have modulated it, we don't know. But even saying that, there's a phenomenal amount of Mussar and basic human piety in there. For example, even though Reichstalers are very important, it's clear that Gluckel is scrupulously honest. Even when she has extremely straitened circumstances, she describes the pain that she goes to in order to pay off each and every debt. And the pride that she feels when she has no debts left whatsoever, that she has in fact returned everyone their due, is very clear and is honest in the book. So we can certainly identify with those positive values of honesty in business that Gluckel refers to. In fact, one of the highest words of praise that she can offer to her ancestors was a phrase that repeats over and over and over: he was respected by Jew and Gentile alike. Meaning that, you know, my father, my father-in-law, my cousin's brother, they were all respected because of their honesty in business. And I think that's something that says great things about Gluckel. She herself was deeply pious, as I mentioned. She wished to retire in the land of Israel, and in fact it was her children who talked her out of it to have her get married once again. And it's clear that that she has a very strong, deeply religious sense within her. She refers often to going to synagogue, reciting psalms, and so on. Her legacy is of inestimable value for students of the 17th century, students of Jewish history, students of women's history, to some degree students of German history. She went on to have many significant descendants throughout the 19th century, including the great poet Heinrich Heine was a descendant of Gluckel of Hameln. And we rejoice in reading her memoir and trying to understand a little bit about what life was like for her at the end of the 17th century. I'm especially grateful that you could sit through this whole video if you're listening to it even now. And I'm really looking forward to speaking to all of you in person, God willing, next Wednesday in Florida. If you want to have my father and not mine, his name is Yaakov Dov Ben Pava. Yishav Refuah Shleimah. Okay, thank you very much.